Welcome to Some Assembly Required. It's been a little over a year since I announced this project and about 30 videos. It's finally time to explain what I'm actually trying to do here. Let's start by reviewing the hardware we're working on. Of course, by now it is no secret that I'm basing the final product on the Spartan 7 board from QMTech. So let's see what that has. First and foremost, we have the FPGA itself, the XE7S15 FPGA. Next to it, we have the DDR memory with 256 megabytes of RAM. That is way, way, way more than we can possibly hope to ever need. We also have an SPI flash, the MT28QL 128, which holds 60 megabytes of ROM. Now, the FPGA configuration is loaded from this chip, but since that only needs a little over half a megabyte, we have plenty of room left if we need it. The board also sports an HDMI port and a USB port. Except the USB port isn't really general purpose USB. It's actually the CP2102, which is a UART adapter. So we have RAM, ROM, and display. What we're still missing are inputs, in particular keyboard and joystick, and storage. Luckily, some of the FPGA pins are still in use and they're exported through this header. You will also notice that the board has holes, which we can use in order to create a daughter board, which will fit above it. The plan is to add a USB switch as well as an SD card port. I may be able to also add a real-time clock. We'll see. Now that we understand what peripherals we'll need, let's have a look at what goes on inside the FPGA itself. FPGAs are built of predetermined resources. Programming an FPGA means deciding on configurations for some of those resources and determining which resources connect to which. The main resources we need from the RFPGA are flip-flops and LUTs. Flip-flops are synchronous memory units. When the clock ticks, the flip-flop sets its output to the input and continues to output the same value until the next clock tick, even if the input changes. LUTs, or lookup tables, are just a fancy way of encoding asynchronous logic. In other words, take any sequence of logic gates without a clock, and that sequence can be translated into a sequence of one or more LUTs. So deciding whether our design can fit inside our FPGA means answering the question, how many flip-flops and LUTs do we need, and how many does the FPGA have? The second one is the easier one to answer. The XE7S15 has 8,000 LUTs and 16,000 flip-flops. We also have 20 DSP slices and 360 kilobit of block RAM, which translates to about 40 kilobytes of RAM. Because of reasons, we need to divide by 9 instead of by 8. So how much resources do we need? My current 6502 implementation takes around 850 LUTs. We don't have enough block RAM for our needs, so we'll need to use the DDR memory on the board. The reference DDR3 controller supplied with the Xilinx tools need around 2,000 LUTs. The HDMI controller needs a similar amount. This means we're at 5,000 LUTs and we haven't even gotten to the input. Because here's the complicated part. I want USB keyboard, I want USB joystick, and I want SD card storage. Of the three, controlling an SD card as a block device is the easiest. Sadly, it's not very useful. A typical SD card is 8 to 16 gigabytes. An Apple II floppy is 140 kilobytes. Storing more than one floppy image on a single SD card is expected. This means we want the SD card to be formatted with a file system. Now, to be fair, the Mr. Apple II implementation doesn't do that. It uses the SD card as raw storage. As a result, whatever the SD card size is, we're effectively only utilizing 140 kilobytes. Even so, I want to do better. However, writing hardware to handle a file system is insane. It is a classic software workload, which means we need another CPU on the FPGA to perform control functions. Luckily, GitHub has delivered. The VexiRISC-V project has a modular RISC-V CPU that can require as little as 550 LUTs. We will need to set it up with its own memory and with some minimal operating system, but we have the memory to spare for that. And this is where things get interesting. Once we have a modern CPU controlling the whole operation, we can set it to work to do other things as well. At a minimum, it can translate between the format Apple II floppy images are usually downloaded to the insane encoding that the Apple II hardware provides, and the software therefore expects. We can also connect the USB device to it. Since the CPU is hopefully underutilized, we can dumb down the USB hardware controller and transfer a lot of its logic to software, thus saving on LUTs. Of course, all of that may not be enough. Or it might be enough for implementing the Apple II, but not other computers. The Apple II is one of the simplest personal computers produced, and I, for one, would not consider CompuSAR done until it also supports at least the Commodore 64. Originally, I was planning on basing the device on the QMTech evaluation board, as it only cost $30. However, the supply chain collapse has reached here as well, and that board is no longer available. As such, getting this to be available to the general public will probably require designing my own layout for it. If I'm doing that, I'm not tied to the specific FPGA that QMTech chose. The XC7S25 has 14,600 LUTs and 29,200 flip-flops. That's an 80% increase in the resources that matter to us for only $12 more. What's more, it has 180 kilobytes of block RAM. Not only is this a 350% increase over the XC7S15, it is more RAM than our 8-bit machines have. This opens up a bunch of possibilities that may come in very handy indeed. Which brings me to the elephant in the room. How do I get this into the general public's hands? Because here's the thing. This project is meaningless if I'm the only one who can enjoy it. Originally, I was hoping that I could just design the I/O expansion board with the USB and SD card slots. Those are relatively simple, even for a beginner like me, and should not cost much. I can then either sell them to anyone who wants them or just publish the Gerber files and let people print their own versions while buying the main board from QMTech. With the QMTech board going out of stock, however, that option is out the window, which means I'll have to design a brand new layout from scratch. Here's the problem though. Such a layout is not easy to design. Any layout with DDR3 memory requires a large amount of traces with very strict constraints about how they're laid out. This is something best done by a professional, and that costs money. So the obvious answer is to open a Kickstarter campaign or some other form of mass financing. Well, that's certainly an option. I'll only go that route once I'm ready to deliver. I don't want to raise money and then have people wait a long time for boards to arrive. I also don't want people to get boards and then wait a very long time for those boards to become usable as the software and design try to catch up. I only want to take your money once I've convinced myself I can deliver. Speaking of taking your money, I have a Patreon page. If you like what I do here and are okay with less tangible returns, please consider becoming a supporter. In particular, each video I pick two supporters and thank them personally. As such, I would like to thank Loris Modenese and Chris Lydiard. Thank you for all your faith in me. So, this is where we are. I hope you have a better understanding of what's planned for the project, as well as why I may seemingly randomly start to spend a lot of time on yet another rewrite of the 6502 or implementing a cache for the DDR where the original Apple II had none. These are just pieces of the puzzle that still need to come together. So, thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.